First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air, no doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories. Shit that works.
Peace. Apologize for the technical difficulties.
All right, that's okay.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with Skype and Blog Talk tonight, but I'm going to try to make it through as much as possible here.
All right.
But, Spider, how you doing tonight, Brother L?
I'm doing fine, brother. Great.
Okay, all right. You got any thoughts on the topic for tonight? On the mystery of life, death, and reincarnation? What's your perspectives on it? And, of course, what does the March on the Quran Circle 7 got to say about that?
Well, actually, it gives credence to that nobody really never dies, you know.
Right.
That what we're in is in the vessels. This is our vessels that we are inside of temporarily, and it's our responsibility to take care of our vessels and our temples until transition. When transition comes upon us.
You know, right.
So, yeah. So that also gives a better understanding of what real life and what real death is. You know, there is no death, you know, but only transition into another. Another plane.
Right.
Mhm. Yes.
No doubt about it. Well, let's go into these various planes that you're talking about, because from my research perspective, there's about seven of them. You know, at least the major seven planes are conscious levels. Of course, you have the physical plane, which is the material plane.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the plane of force, which is the ethereal plane. You have the emotional plane, which is the astral plane.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have the mental plane. You have the causal plane. You have the spiritual plane. And you have the soul plane. All right? So these are the seven heavens. But these seven heavens correlate to the seven Elohims, or the seven chakra points or systems, which is your points of light or vectors of light, your portals, your wormholes, whatever you want to refer to them as, these are your seats of light. These are your endocrine glands, all right? Mm-hmm. Which produces chemicals from these ductless glands. These chemicals right. produced is what creates hormonal balance. So this is how you stay in tune with the laws of Mayat,
mm-hmm.
all right, in that aspect of being in balance. So when you're looking at these particular, we know that you have a physical body, you have an ethereal body, which is about 2 inches above, which normally the colors look like, you know, a bluish color. Then you have the expansive body, which is called the astral body, which is about 3 feet outside of you. That is also known as your emotional body. Then you have your mental body, all right? Then you also have your causal body, your spiritual body, and your soul body. So you mm-hmm. have 7 conscious levels. Internal and as well as external. And those external 7 heavens correlate to the 7 atmospheres. We talk about from the lowest atmosphere to the stratosphere, the magnetosphere, the mesosphere, the ionosphere, and et cetera. So those 7 correlate to those 7. It's a known fact that if you get the Unk book written by Nur Unk Amin, he states that heaven, the heaven in which that the Muslims, Jews, and Christians speak about within their monotheistic belief system, as they claim it that it is, that the heaven that they actually are speaking about is actually in the ionosphere. Right?
That's what they're saying, yeah.
It actually is in the ionosphere. Now, I'm going to get the book, and I'm going to read a portion of it, you know, because it's very important, you know. But before I get to it, let me go back and we'll tie all this information in. Because we just finished listening to KRS-One 1995. I said 94, but it's 95 hit of that metaphysical classic, I Year, in which that, you know, gives you over those 2 particular verses that this is not the first time I came to this planet. But every time I come, only a few could understand it. I came in Isis. My words, they tried to ban it. I came in Moses. They couldn't follow my commandments. I came in Solomon to a people that was lost. I came as Jesus, but they nailed me to the cross. I came as Harriet Tubman. I put the truth in Sojourner. Other times, I had to come back in Nat Turner. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I mean, that right there is profound, you know. That's one of the most profound lyrics in hip-hop, you know, that's ever been spoken, you know. And we're not even done with it. I mean, shoot. I mean, he went so far as said, at other times I had to come back in Nat Turner. They tried to burn me, lynch me, and starve me. So mm-hmm. I had to come back as Marcus Garvey, Bob Marley. They tried to harm me. I used to be Malcolm X. Now I'm on the planet as the one called KRS, kicking the metaphysical, spiritual, trying to get, you know what I'm saying, trying to get with you, showing you that you are invincible. The Black mm-hmm. Panthers is Black Answer for real. In my spiritual form, I turned into Bobby Seals. On the wheel of steel, my spirit flies away and enters into Kwame Ture. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, that, like I said, that's the most powerful lyrics that you can ever do right there, you know. And so, you know, when you do your research, mm-hmm. you know, when you're talking about reincarnation, that is something of which that is profound within itself. And, of course, the scripture speaks about reincarnation. Matter of fact, for those who are, you know, into Christianity, Jesus specifically stated or told his disciples, well, whom do they say that I am? And the disciples were saying, well, some say that you are Jeremiah. Some say that you are Elijah or one of the prophets of old, you know. And then he asked Peter, well, Peter, whom do you say that I am? And Peter said, oh, you're the living Christ, the Son of God, basically. So, you know, if Jesus disagreed with the reincarnation, he should have stopped his, he shouldn't even have asked a question about who do the Pharisees or Sadducees or who do the people say that he is. In other words, how did they know that he meant spiritually? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Or soulfully. How did they know that? You see what I'm saying? So,
yes.
And then we see another lesson within another portion of the Bible in the New Testament where it speaks about the disciples saying that, well, we heard that surely that Elijah will come in the last days of the Lord, or the dreadful days of the last days of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And surely he did. That was John the Baptist. You know, so here it is. Elijah supposed to have existed 1,000 or more years before John the Baptist, you know, and here it is. He's being said to be, Elijah was supposed to have existed 1,000 years before John the Baptist, but here it is that John the Baptist is supposed to be Elijah, and Jesus is verifying it. So also showing the signs of reincarnation, even within Christianity, even though they try to state that they don't believe in it, but these are two prime examples within the New Testament in which that proves that it is. You know,
mm-hmm.
So go ahead, brother.
Yes, they're trying to put that message through the Bible. Although it was bastardized so much, but they had put it through the Bible so many times that a lot of the Christians don't really understand it, you know, the way it's put in the Bible. But if they really understand it in its esoteric sense, like we do, they can really see it. You know, like Jesus, when they said he had died and ascended to the heavens, it wasn't talking about the physical death. It was talking about the spiritual, the material death of the self ascending to the spiritual life.
Right.
Yes. But you try to tell most of these your Christian church members that. You try to really get them to understand, and you explain it to them in the way you think they might get it. They still don't get it,
right?
Because they're so steep until their exoteric way of thinking, how life and death, they understand how life and death is really taught to them,
right?
Through generations, through generations, through generations, through generations, through generations.
Right.
The beat goes on.
Right. No doubt. So let me break this down, because Dr. Masaru Emoto, who's the Japanese scientist who did the discovery that there's spirit in water, which is an old discovery. Africans and other indigenous people on the planet Earth have been saying that for millions and probably billions of years, that there's life in water, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a recent discovery that when you say something beautiful to a glass of water and you freeze it and look at it under a microscope, you see a six-point star configuration, snowflake, beautiful.
Uh-huh.
When you say something negative to a glass of water and freeze it and then look at it under glass of water under a microscope, it looks discombobulated.
Hmm.
So Dr. Masaru Emoto said that he came to the realization that these crystals are spirits. Okay?
Mm.
These crystals are spirits. These snowflakes in which that exists, in which that they were seen under the microscopes, those are actually spirits, because they are able to construct or conform into a six-point star configuration with positive affirmations or words as compared to something negative. And think about the fact that your body is 75% water, your brain is 90% water, your liver is 85% water, your spine is 82% water, your bones are 25% water, and et cetera, et cetera. So you are mm-hmm. an aquatic being. So, you know, if you were saying positive things, then, you know, then what could happen? So let's go into that science, because Dr. Emoto said that he came to the realization that these crystals are spirits.
Mm-hmm.
There are many parallels. He said when ice melts, the crystalline structure becomes an illusion. It's there, yet it is not there, because you cannot longer see it. Similarly, when a person dies, the body loses several grams of weight. when some people think of this weight is of the soul. Basically, the soul is the breath of life, which is the electronic vapor molecule. The whole life is written upon your breath of life, the inhalation and exhalation. You don't believe me? Stop breathing and see what happens.
Exactly.
All right? Now, what is that? That is a form of melanin, dark matter, because that's the glue in which that holds the universe together. It's the glue in which that holds centrifugal and centripetal force together, which is the push and pull factor.
Yes.
Which holds your molecular structure together. So this action and reaction force pair associated with a circular motion, which is that elliptical pattern, which is the same as the DNA, which is the same as the Kundalini, ascendant or ascendant. So this centripetal force can be supplied as a push force or the magnetic force, while the centrifugal force can be supplied as the pull force or the the electrical force. In other words, you have what's called electromagnetism. Now, the thing about the interaction of the two forces is that it causes your emotion. This is what causes your emotional body to exist, which is your auric field. But when we, which basically, you know, for those who have an open eye can actually see visually. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So you have to think that the soul has mass. And if it returns to water molecules, because it has mass, it's affected by the gravitational pull of the planet Earth. And so every time the soul cannot transition over to the other side, we travel here to Earth on the water crystals of spheres of ice. So Earth is not our native home. However, most people on the planet are not able to obtain enlightenment.
Mm-hmm.
So to reach enlightenment means that you are able to completely let go of the ego and otherworldly attachments. All right,
yeah.
Now, you know, this is talk with Buddhism. This is talk within yogi traditions and et cetera. All right? Even the Christians say, you know, let this yoke pass from me. You know what I'm saying? Or do not let it be more than I can bear. You know what I'm saying? So all that is talking about the same thing. So in the past 100 years or so, the population has increased from 1 billion to 6 billion people. Now, during these 100 years, war, capitalism has dominated the planet. So rather than being able to detach from our desires, the opposite has become true. And our desires have grown and grown. And very few people have been able to obtain enlightenment in this environment. In other words, they reincarnate. But I'll get to that in a second. It says, so few souls have been able to go home, and I believe they have remained on Earth in the form of water. This concept, or this connection in the concept of reincarnation, where these souls keep falling back to Earth and need to redo their lives here. So the question is asked, so when a person dies, if they are unable to obtain enlightenment at that time, their souls remain on this planet as water. Now check this out. Dr. Emoto broke it down, and he goes further. He said, this is why I believe, yes, the Japanese character for spirit, which is Shin within Chinese, and actually within the Egyptian is Shin also, is a combination of the word rain and soul. People who have seen ghosts report seeing them in wet or in places where there's a lot of humidity, as if the imprint of the soul, which is in the form of water, certainly takes form when surrounded by water or moisture, much like a mirage. So by receiving beautiful thoughts and feelings and words and music, our ancestral spirits get lighter and are now able to make the transition home. When we consider this, we can see the importance of transition like Oben, which is during the summertime in Japan when they acknowledge their ancestral spirits. When we are alive, the human body is at approximately 36 degrees Celsius, which is 98.6 degrees. This is the temperature of the fluids in the body. When we die, this goes to 0 degrees Celsius. When we die and go to the other side, crossing the water, we're no longer able to move our bodies, but the crystalline structure of our soul emerges. It's like water. When the water turns to ice, the crystalline structure becomes visible, but it is also immobile. So crystal equals spirit. All right. So crystal is spirit. Now, for y'all to get more information, you have to check out Messages from Water, Volume 1, 2, and 3 by Masato Emoto. Also, The Hidden Messages in Water, and also Water Crystal Healing, Music and Images to Restore Your Whole Being, and also The Shape of Love. All right, so you have to get those particular books by Dr. Emoto, and he breaks it down as far as that is concerned. Now, I had to say that to say this, that's very important to understand. All right, because we all say, dealing with this metaphysical information or esoteric information, that God resides within the human body, but also along with the entire cosmos.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so everything of value is within a home, the human body, nothing without. The esoteric quest without is but an illusion. You understand that? So a person who always examining everything outside of themselves, that is merely an illusion. All right? Now, when you come and do your research on life, death, reincarnation principle, the certain things in which that you're going to have to be, in which that will have to be verified, get the book called The Perfection of Yoga by Swami Prabhupada. This is what he says now. There are many planets in the universe, and on the highest planets, there are greater comforts. Durations of life is longer, and the inhabitants are more righteous, religious, which is spiritual, and godly. Right? He says Vedic or Vedic literature describes their lifetimes as lasting as 10,000 years. So when the Christians read about, you know, in my father's house, there are many mansions.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they're talking about.
Exactly.
In my father's house, there are many mansions. There are many dimensions, many density levels. There's many realms. There's many cosmic zones or planets in this mm-hmm. universe. And on the higher planets, all right, the inhabitants are more religious and godly and righteous. And they live, you know what I'm saying, to ages 10,000 years and longer. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we talking about, this is why this is one of the lowest planes, because the lifespan here is 70 years on the average. You know, falling
right.
from 120, falling from Methuselah, who lived to be 969 years. Okay, which is nearly 1,000 years, and it says that, and that was only a day unto the Lord. 1,000 years is only a day unto the Lord, based on the Bible and the Quran. So, niggas has never even lived a day on this planet. You know what I'm saying? As far as that is concerned, based on the amount of years in which that has been accounted for, based if it's based on mythology or whether it's based on actual fact. But yet, on these other
mm-hmm.
planets, if you cross over, as we say, and your heart is lighter than a feather. Remember, that's the ancient Kemetic philosophy, is that in order to transcend and not to have to incarnate and go to these possible other higher planes of existence, your heart will have to be lighter than a feather. If your heart is heavier than a
mm-hmm.
feather, then guess
yeah.
what? You're reincarnate and coming back here. And Animus, which is this creature, which looked like a head of a crocodile, body of something else, you know, it's this monstrous creature, which is standing right near the scales of balance, which is called the scales of the Mayat, in which that he eats the heart, which means he eats the memories and the desires. And so you come back into this plane with no memory or recollection of your last incarnation. And most of you can't remember beyond the age of 2.
Right.
Okay. Most cannot even remember beyond the age of 2.
Right. Okay.
You know, so that's what we're looking at. That's really what we're looking at. You know, what's your thoughts on it, Brother L?
Yes. My thoughts on that, especially when you talked about blue, the water, the crystals, as being spirits. I did a breathing and meditation today in the park behind where I live, behind where I live at. And I did the breathing exercises, and also the one nostril, left nostril, and the right nostril breathing exercise, as you taught me. And it's like it always, when I my eyes open up, it always was blue, dark blue. It came out a dark blue. And I said, well, let me try this other technique that Dr. Eileen taught me over the phone.
Mm-hmm.
I tried that, and it still came out a dark blue. And I said, well, what can you tell me on that? What was that experience?
Well, remember, the color blue is the color of your ethereal body, so that means that you was on the etheric plane.
Okay.
All right? So when you meditated, you were able to go into the conscious plane of the plane of force, which is the ethereal plane. That's what the color blue symbolizes. Remember, I said that the color blue is the color above your physical body, which is called your etheric body or your ethereal body.
All right. Okay. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
I did that today, and I felt pretty good because when I got through, I got up and walked away. I was like I was a lot more energized, you know.
Because he was working with etheric energy, which is prana.
Okay. Did that have anything to do with the Kundalini?
Yeah, the Kundalini. Yeah, all of that. Bringing energy into your body. You're bringing energy into your chakra centers, and that affects the Kundalini, in which that creates an upswelling of energy. So your melanin is able to absorb prana, which is this particular ethereal energy, in which that you were seeing because you was tuned into the plane of force. So you was able to receive much more prana than normal. Because you was in a somewhat of a trance-like state. And when you go into a trance-like state, that's when you're able to absorb more prana or more energy or ki or chi, as they refer to it as, is when you are in that particular moment, especially if you're conscious about it and you're doing it consciously and you're going in with that intent and you're able to absorb more. And by doing so, you create a longevity or you lengthen your DNA strand, in which that give you a longer lifespan. You know what I'm saying? It's a known fact that, you know, if you practice Qigong for 2 years, you know, you would have added, you know, more than 5 years to your life.
All right.
You know,
I knew it had something to do. But when you kept on talking about the etheric plane, you had the blue, and I said, "That's what I experienced today."
Right.
That's what I experienced today. And when I got up after doing my exercises, my meditation and breathing exercises, and I walked away, I felt a lot more energized. You know, I walked across the grass, and like I was a lot more faster than I came when I first came out in the park.
No doubt.
I knew I had to tap into those Kundalini chakras, especially the spinal, down in the spine with the fire, what they call the serpentine fire.
Right, exactly.
Yes.
Well, the more that you're able to accumulate, the more you'll create an upswelling of energy in your spine, which is at your sacral bone area, which is the Kundalini abode, and you're able to raise that energy through your chakra system with your endocrine glands up your spinal column, and you're able to develop certain gifts, you know, what is called siddhas, which is based on telepathy, telepathics, telekinesis, clairvoyance, clairaudience, clairguestance, clairsentience, you know, psychemistry, various, you start to develop these various gifts.
Yes. It was kind of hard for me for somebody for if it's hard for someone to make me mad if they say something very insulting to me, because that was the kind of plane I was on. You know, it made me more a lot more friendlier and more my mind was more at rest or at ease, so to speak.
Right. Got you.
Yeah.
Right.
So it had me like I can deal with the people a whole lot more better than I normally do.
Right. Check this out, brother, because according to written by Dr. Suzar, she states that humanity's first prototype began as long-lived, godlike, ethereal, hermaphroditic beings that gradually polarized into opposite sexes and solidified into flesh form.
Hmm.
So that means when you make the transition, you know what I'm saying, and it's based on your vibratory rate, based on your frequency, based on your conscious level. And remember the seven states of consciousness that correlate to the seven Elohims. You have interpersonal consciousness, intrapersonal consciousness, life consciousness, subconsciousness, magnetic, superconsciousness, magnetic consciousness, and infinite consciousness. Those are the seven. Based on the level which that you pass, you know, which is based on the predominance of your thought patterns, on what you've told yourself about your lifetime.
Okay. Yes. Uh-huh.
Right. That is the level in which that you will be raised at the point of death. And if you do not get beyond the subconscious, which is the heart plane, hence weighing the heart upon, you know, against the feather, then you have to come back. You know, so that means if you reach what is known as super consciousness, magnetic consciousness, or infinite consciousness, then you are in your immortal body. Therefore, you have made it beyond reincarnation and therefore do not have to reincarnate. However, if you do not make it based on your attachment, based on, and I give you a good example of heaven and hell. Do they exist? Of course they do, but they are state of mind. All right?
Yeah.
In other words, they exist as state of mind. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what exists after the physical body. Not only is the crystalline water vapor which exit the body upon exhalation, you know what I'm saying, which the spirit is being pulled out the body, you know what I'm saying, which deals with centrifugal or centripetal force in that particular regard. Centrifugal force, which deals with the pulling factor, because that's what happens upon death, you exhale. Remember, when you come into the body at birth, you inhale.
Right.
You know, you come in and you inhale
uh-huh.
as you exhale.
Exactly.
You exhale. So life is nothing but insulation and exhalation. And in between that, that is what holds the physical composition together, your molecular structure together, is insulation and exhalation. So it's based on the breath. So the more you can balance the breath, inhaling and exhaling, the more you keep your physical composition together and the more you lengthen your life. All right?
Right.
So, not just lengthen your life, you can also gain immortality because there's the ability in order to dematerialize and materialize or rematerialize. All right? That is something else in which that is dealing with the rainbow body or the golden body, in which that the audience need to look up and start the research and study on. Okay? Anything you want to build on that, Brother L?
Yes, sir. I noticed that when I did go into the meditation trance and the breathing exercises, I know for some reason I always had the picture of my great-great-grandmother, which is a Choctaw Moor. She was always
right,
coming to the picture, and I don't even have her on my mind. Have her on my mind at the time, and I'm like,
right.
Wow, what is this about? You know.
Mm-mm.
What is this about?
So what you think it is? What you think that's about, brother? Because here you are, you know, subconsciously, you know, whatever you think about is going to rise to the surface, because that's what the subconscious mind does, is brings to the, you know, things to the conscious mind. It's up to you, though, as the seer, to to decide on what you think about it, what is being revealed to you, as well as also the symbolism in it.
My understanding of it is that I'm really connecting with my great great grandmother.
Right.
I'm really connecting. We are connecting. And as they say, or like what other people talk about, necromancy, connecting with the spirits, with your ancestors.
Right.
And I believe that that's what I was doing, but unconsciously I was doing it. Unconsciously, because that wasn't what I was intending to do. I was intending to go out here, sit out here, redo my breathing exercises and the breathing techniques you taught me, and everything. But she would always pop up when my eyes were closed. A picture.
Right.
Her face would always pop up at me.
Well, remember, that's the pathway that you're following. A lot of her genealogy has popped up, within you,
mm-hmm.
And the simple fact of it is that that's obvious based on, from what we've been able to tell so far, that if she keep popping up to you, then, that normally means that there's genes or DNA in which that is popping up ancestrally through you, because that's where the ancestors go to after they die, is actually into you. You know what I'm saying? In other words, back into the concentration of the physical body, back into the physical body, to become, an egg or sperm or whatever the case is, but that comes by way of the breath and by way of your genealogy and by way of, as we would see, as we also call your genes or whatever the case is. So, that's how that happens,
mm-hmm.
So we analyze that, that we can see that's what grandma really, great grandma was really, on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we can see
all
that.
Right.
We definitely can see, matter of fact, there's a good book in which that everyone definitely need to get. All right, let me get to it right quick. It's an excellent book. Let me see. Hopefully I can get it. All right. This is The Secret Doctrine of Madame Blavatsky. Now, she writes that the first race to evolve on Earth was astral beings, a race pure in spirit. All right.
Okay.
Then she said the second race was known as Hyperborean race. They used to live on a now vanished continent in the Northern Ocean. The third race was known or called the Lemurians, or Lemurians, who fell because of interbreeding with the earthly elements.
Mm.
All right. Now understand what all of this is meaning, because you're talking about astral beings, ethereal beings, and then how we finally came fleshly beings. She says the fourth race was known as the Atlanteans, who possessed psychic powers and who lived in gigantic cities, and a great flood destroyed them. Then she goes on to say the fifth race was known as the founders of ancient Egypt culture, and soon they will rise to the pinnacle of spirituality. The sixth and the seventh race or races will come to exist in the future when the present fifth race experiences a racial, check this out now, when the present fifth root race experienced a racial calamity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Which will cut it into two halves. The same occurred, also happened to the fourth and the third race. The Lemurians, the sixth and the seventh root races, will also experience a racial calamity. Okay. So, if we don't get this thing right, as far as the so-called races are concerned, even Madame Blavatsky said that it would result in these particular races, which is these particular fifth race, even the sixth and the seventh loop race may even experience that. All right, so that means we definitely got to get this right, because based on all the information that we've been gathering, the indigenous people around the planet, they're saying that we're now going into the fifth dimension or the fifth world.
Right.
You know, and so we'll be dealing with energy. So we'll be dealing with a lot of energy. Okay?
Okay,
now, Don. Now, check this out. Now, we're talking about the Choctaw. Let's look what the Choctaw says, because they was called also the Blackfoot. They was also called the Tar Heel. But check this out. This is what they teach. They teach that every star was once a human being.
Hmm.
Well, that's because every human being was once a star. Scientists have found out that the physical body or the physical composition is composed of stardust particles. The Dakota tribe speaks of the spirit in the skies, often descended to earth in human form. The Hopis call them Kachina. Now, the Iroquois tells us that a woman fell from the skies. Now, guess what? That is the same told to us within the oracles of the Zulu the bones of the Zulu oracles, Zulu bone oracles, that's the name of it, by the guy who was interviewed by David Icke, or some people call him Icky. David Icky, mm-hmm. He's David Icke. But Credo Mutua, in his book, Zulu Bone Oracle, he speaks of the fact that the woman was called Macabre, as in the Macabre, and that the last planet that we was on before it became the Earth was our sixth, was the sixth planet that we, fifth planet, excuse me, that we resided on prior to coming to this sixth planet, was the planet Mars, which was the red planet, and that we was there prior to coming here, and that we impregnated our women, and they transformed themselves into macabres, and they was able to travel to the planet Earth. You know what I'm saying? During the time of destruction. I'll get to that destruction information in a second here, but the Arika teaches that man came from a previous world. The Algonquin tells of the script descended from the skies upon the skies of man. In other words, we came as spirits and we descended from the skies and took on the elements, as we said, as Madame Blavatsky said, of the earthly elements, and became man form. And we know that because you have iron in your body, you have silver in your body, you have gold, mercury, you have arsenic, you have copper, you have, you know, oxygen. You have all of these elements, whether it's elements off the periodical chart or whether it's elements off the back of the goddamn cereal box. You are made up of elements. You see what I'm saying, brother?
That's right. But
right.
You know what?
Now
the oddest thing,
right,
you talk about, Madam. Okay, great.
No, I'm just getting ready to say the Chippewa told of Bessini Yanika, which means a man from the stars. The Cree speaks of the Sky Father along with the Trickster, all right, aiding man and taught man civilization. The Osage refers to the Mekati or the Mekaki, or which you call the star people. Now, the AmaZulu people in Africa, the word AmaZulu means sky people. Okay, now you get this book called The Star Ancestors by Nancy Red Star. She states, when it was time to populate this earth, many spirits came from other planets. As the spirits entered the atmosphere, they took on the atomic structure which formed into a body. When we exit, we dematerialize the atomic structure.
Wow.
Okay. Well, go ahead, brother. I didn't want to go ahead.
That's okay. Yes, I was when you brought up Madame Blavatsky, I'm looking across my living room of one of my bookshelves. And there's The Secret Doctrine, Part 1 and Part 2. But,
oh, yeah, that's it.
And I couldn't, you know, the reason I'm glad I'm talking to you right now, because I really couldn't understand those books. You know, I really
yes.
wasn't in that far in my cosmologics, my cosmogenics,
mm-hmm.
and I wasn't that far
right.
into it until I started studying
right.
more science.
Right. Well, brother, I'm probably one of the best ones to break this shit down the easiest.
Okay.
You know, I break this stuff down to layman terms so that everybody understands what the hell is going on, whether it's a street nigga or whether it's a damn Harvard-educated bourgeoisie boule nigga.
Right.
It doesn't matter.
I hear you, boy.
Right. We'll get it popping in one way or another.
All right.
You know,
right.
If I have to go to my educated, you know, college voice, or whether it's just me chilling on the streets, chilling, and me and you just kicking it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And be getting it.
All right.
How it comes, that's the way it comes. That's the spirit in which that has moved me that day.
Yes.
You know? So, check this out. So we know that basically the spirit, which is a crystalline energy source, right? Water vapor, crystalline water vapor, right? Which is a star particle. That's basically what all this is, brother. That's what all this is adding up to.
Mm-hmm.
We know that 300,000 tons of stardust energy falls into the planet Earth daily. So we took on this stardust material, which is called the element, and we condensed and we became part of it. That's God. God became its creation. Kundalini prana, or prana kundalini, became its creation. She didn't create something else. She became her creation. She became it. All right. So the Theosophists insist that man is definitely older than the ape species. And we concur that because the ape
mm-hmm.
is part of the experimentation to make mankind.
Exactly.
Okay. They say that the first man was Etherian, which is a light being, whose form, you know what I'm saying, over the course of years and ages, became more condensed until it attuned itself to the slowest vibration of material plane, which is the Earth. And it assumed an apparent solid physical body. You appear to be solid, but guess what? 99.9999% of your atomic structure is empty space.
Right.
That means only 1% of you appears to be solid. You're not a solid being.
That explains a holographic.
Right,
when they think about holograph.
Right. You got it. That explains the holographs. So you have what they taught you in school, the three levels. You have solid, liquid, and gas. Now think about it. You have all three of them right now in your body. You appear to be a solid, a fleshly material being. You have liquid in your body, which is 75% water. You have gas in your body, which is the breath of life. So you are a condensed being of all three of these states. But see, they only tell you about three of these states. Go to the Rosicrucian teachings and you get the other four.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
You have your chemical ether. You have life ether. You have light ether. And you have thought ether. Those are the other four states that they never told us about. They just told you solid, liquid, and gas. ABC, 1, 2, 3.
Those are the four ethers of the etheric body, right?
Right. The four
mm-hmm.
etheric bodies.
Mm-hmm.
Which is
bodies.
What's in chemical yeah. ether. So above gas is chemical ether.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have life ether, L-I-F-E, life ether. Then you have light ether, L-I-G-H-T. Then you have thoughts or mental ether. And it's from that thought ether in which that you fell to a light ether, because thought travels 24 billion miles per second. Light travels
right.
only 186,000 miles per second. Sound, which is a form of ether, which is light ether, travels 1,129 feet per second, you know, and which that produces the chemicals, you know what I'm saying, or the hormones, you know, which is the dendrites and the synapses as they fire off, you know what I'm saying? This all is part of this sequence here of what is known as chemical ether, in which that produces the gas or give you the tangent of the gas in which that forms later on, you know, the liquid in which that condenses even further to become a flesh or material or physical being, which is a solid, apparent solid. It's an apparent solid. It's not actually a solid. It appears to be. So such materialization descended into the entire visible seen universe. People in it, not only Earth, but all third-dimensional planets.
Mm-hmm.
You see this? So then,
yeah.
This hasn't happened just to this planet. There's other third-dimensional planets where this same shit is going on. It's called parallel Earths or parallel universes. Or better yet, parallel worlds. So thus, this condensation of this spirit builds the body that appears to be born. It's this ethereal body in which that builds the physical body in which that appears to be born. Matter of fact, J.E. Boyd pointed out a regular pattern in the planets, distance from the sun. And according to Boyd's law, he calculated that this should be a planet between Mars and Jupiter. Now, this goes back to what I was talking about. Now, Professor Ober, he speculated that the asteroid belt was the ruins of a fifth planet. Many scientists today agree with this philosophy.
Hmm.
All right? In the astrological sense, Lucifer, the son of the morning, the fallen angel, actually was the planet located between the two planets now called Mars and Jupiter. It was called Moldic or Vulcan.
Hmm.
Right, which is called the tongue of fire. All right, within the Sumerian text. Now, y'all can get this from Zachariah Ascension's information.
Mm-hmm.
He spoke about it, you know, within his book, The 12th Planet. All right. Now, what is calculated is that there was an asteroid. Now, it says long ago that Moldic was a third dimensional planet with a full conscious life form upon it that was humanoid in shape. Since life form was not restricted by reincarnation, but rather stepped in and out of form at will. In other words, there was a force upon us. Now it is based on our fallen level of consciousness. In other words, you put yourself into this state of a heaven or a hell. The solar system at this time consists of two suns, all right? The sun itself and Jupiter, which is called the blue sun. Those were the two suns in the solar system. This is why they many years ago they sent missiles to Jupiter in order to blow Jupiter up and to ignite it back into a blue sun. Dr. Phil Valentine spoke about this years ago. They did this back in the mid-90s. Y'all can look this up. It's on. I'm pretty sure it's on YouTube or on the internet. So there's many accounts that Moldic, who has been called Vulcan, Lucifer, Phoenix, or Astra, that's what these various names are, but if you go to it, you'll find out that the loss of this planetary body in the solar system resulted in the inequality of sexes on the Earth. The energies of Venus and Mars normally would be integrated by the Maldekian planetary field as the energy waves of each planet intersects with the Earth. Without the integration of the energy by Moldic field, a slow growing separation occurred between male and female sexes. This is how this separation came about. I'm explaining to you how this happened.
Wow.
Unity slowed, fell away, and the Atlanteans became more prone to the effects as they drew so much from this energy from the planetary grid. This was the war in heaven that was the manifestation or manifested on Earth. All right? Now, right. It goes on to say that this asteroid hit Moldic and destroyed it, along with the Moldic, its moon was destroyed. All right. Now, y'all can go and check this out. You don't have to believe me. Do your research. All right. You have You have the Urantian book, which that speaks about this. You have Sean David Morton from the Delphi Association newsletter, which that speaks about this. You know, this is something which that has been told for hundreds and thousands of years. This is nothing new. All right? This is new to you. All
right? Right.
But check this out. Like I said, the explosion impelled the survivors to abandon the red planet, which is Mars, in the immigration to Earth, as told in the legends of the Amazulu people and the Hopi natives. You don't believe me? Get the book, The Gods and the Spacemen in the Ancient West by W. Raymond Drake. All right? So Venus was forced closer to the sun, where it turned into a burning furnace, which also caused the Venetians to have to migrate to Earth. All right? I'm telling you how all of this shit happened.
Wow.
Now, Secret Places of the Lion, written by George H. Williamson, he speaks that the spirits, counterfeit, soulless, clones, non-humans, astral entities, non-permanent atom beings, human artificials or earthbound mankind, you know, which came from Modic, was suddenly released onto a different etheric plane and were not welcome on the other culture solar planets, but was forced to incarnate on Earth. This is where you get this story of the fallen angels from. In other words, in the alteration of the molecular structure of Modic, all spirits in physicality who had to become physical at that point in time became trapped in the dream they was creating and was unable to leave and ascend out of the form until the ancient, check this out now, until the ancient Kemites was able to invoke the spirits into the physical form in which they was able to make other human beings, other mankind, which is, of course, these beings that we're talking about. This is how the Modic beings, these Modicians or Modic beings also got here too. But this is another story. I ain't going to get too much in that. You know what I'm saying? Because this goes a little bit too far for Cass, and I don't want y'all to say Dr. Aline is way out there. No, Dr. Aline knows some shit in which that you might need to study.
Yes, sir.
You know, so you can get a clearer understanding of your life existence upon this planet Earth and why things are going the way that they are and what you can do at this time in order to help with being an aid or being a destruction. In other words, a hindrance to the progress. Okay? Now, you can get The Lost Cities of Ancient Lemuria and the Pacifics by David Childress. You can get The Lost Continent of Mu by James Churchward. You know, you can get all these. Now, you say that I'm bugging? Well, go to Robert Temple's book, The Serious Mysteries. All right? The earliest Egyptians believed Sirius was the home of the departed souls, which the Dogons also believed. Mm-hmm. So I'm not tripping.
Right, no, not at all.
Matter of fact, even Alice Bailey said in The Secrets of the Sun, Sirius was, or the hidden, the facts of our, check this out now, in The Secrets of the Sun, Sirius are hidden the facts of our cosmic evolution, and incidentally thereof, of our solar system. This is what Alice Bailey said. Now you got to understand, these individuals in which that is running this planet are theosophical members, Rosicrucian members, Masonic, Shriver members, while you're behind the talking about the Illuminati, and you're not getting this information properly, and you giving it to people like it's some spooky shit, you know, and not understanding your own gifts and power, and neither the mystery of life nor death or reincarnation. You can't explain none of this.
No.
You haven't read enough to damn know anything. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to tell you, like Bobby tell y'all niggas, that he who reads one book knows nothing.
Exactly.
Okay, so we ain't talking about a nigga who just read one book. I've already damn gave you about 50 damn books already. Well, just damn within the last hour.
Wow.
Because all these, I'm telling you about, I have on my bookshelf, and I've read, studied, and comprehended.
Exactly, yes.
This is why I can put this information together the way that I do. And I want everybody else to be having the same ability to do this shit. Because it's the only way we're going to get out of this predicament.
Yeah.
And it's with this information that you shut them up. Right? Matter of fact, go to Serious Mysteries again, like we was talking about. And as a matter of fact, Robert Temple breaks down some things. He says that the north-south section of the Pyramid of Cheops, which is Khufu, shows two so-called air shafts leading out of the king's chamber. All right? We know that these shafts point towards where? We know that they point towards Draco. We know that they point towards Orion. All right? We know that. Based on what the Egyptian says, that if you go towards, if you are in the shaft and your body is magnetized and pulled up through the vortex from the bottom of the pyramid, because that's where the pharaohs would go at when they passed on, their body would be placed there. Or even in initiation, you would get placed there for 3 days and three nights in the sarcophagus. And you would be sedated under meditation state, and you are able to travel throughout those shafts to those particular solar systems and constellations. Now, if you leave your body, which means if you're passed on, there's a known fact that your spirit hovers around your physical body 3 days after death. So during that time period, your body is also placed in the sarcophagus at the in Cheops. And based on how you want to go, this is for the king, for the royal bloodline. If they did not want to reincarnate, then they would go towards Draco. If they wanted to reincarnate, you know what I'm saying, then they would go towards Sirius or Orion. All right?
Now, so everybody's not getting reincarnated.
Well, based on, that's because, you know, the pharaohs and the pharaohs, they had access to higher information. They had access to this information that we're talking about.
Okay.
All right? Now, you can get this information from the Egyptian Mysteries by Lucy Lambie, L-A-M-I-E, Lambie. Lambie. All right, so our solar system receives energy from the three main sources now. These are the three great waves of energy, which sweeps, you know, cycling into our solar system. The main one coming from Sirius. So it's a known fact that the so-called Aetherian Sirians, the so-called Lemurians and Atlanteans, are higher aspects of our soul. And the Lemurians, be of a higher aspect, can telepath, teleport, manifest at will, and use higher vibratory skills. They travel in light vehicles called Makabas, which is these orbs in which that people speak about, or light fields of the spiritual soul. These stargates, vectors, or portals, which are etheric interdimensional energy alignments, which occurs between two points in interstellar space. Right? In other words, a stargate allows higher vibratory energy to pass through it, as we talk about the span of the whole universe, which is 76 quintillion miles in diameter. So these are what these so-called black holes or wormholes are talking about. These are energy, intergalactic or etheric intergalactic dimensional alignments, right? Or two points, or these various points in space. Now, the ethereal photonic energy is gained along the so-called space-time continuum, passing through a subspace vector. Now, moreover, we know, like you said, thought travels 24 billion miles per second. Light travels 186,000 miles per second.
Mm-hmm.
Keep that in mind. Because according to Einstein's theory of relativity, the mass of the body grows in relation to the increase in its velocity. So a mass equals energy that reaches the speed of light would be infinitely large. right? I'll give you a better example. In 1997, Dr. Gerald Finberg supplied a mathematical proof that there is a counterpart to Einstein's mass or his theory of relativity. He named it particles, which is called tachyon particles, which move infinitely fast, a billion times faster than light. Hence, these tachyon particles actually equals thought. This is thought. Remember, thought travels 24 billion miles per second. Light only travels 180,000 miles per second. So tachyon energy, or these particles, is thoughts. Yet it appears to exist when they are reduced to the speed of light, because they don't. It's not reduced. It becomes light. Thought becomes light at 186,000 miles per second. Because you have slowed thought down from 24 billion miles per second to 186,000 miles per second, so it transformed from thought to light.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? I'm trying to explain to you how we get out here. All right? Now, it's a known fact that a macabre, which is a thought vehicle, will break the light barrier with a light boom to that which is symbolic to a sound boom as a light flash. So the macabre transforms to a beam of tachyon, which is thought pulse waves, right? And will accelerate to incredible speeds, right? So that means that you are able to move in your macabre at the speed of thought, which is 24 billion miles per second. Now, I'm saying all this because, remember, I told you earlier that the AmaZulu people, Kriti Mutwa, the shaman, South African shaman healer, he stated that this was our planet that we're now on. Earth is the sixth planet that we're on. But we existed on the red planet, which is Mars, as the fifth planet. But we, even before that, we came from the star constellation Sirius, as the Dogon say. So that means that we existed on several other planets prior to coming here. So that means that we are planet jumpers.
So we are definitely in tune with the universe.
Right. So how did we jump planets? We jump planets by using the macabre. There's a technique by Javala Melchizedek called the 18-breath technique, 24-breath technique, and the 28-breath technique, in which that transforms your physical body into a ship, macabre, which is a light vehicle, which is called the flaming chariot. You go to the book of the Book of Kings and look up Elijah was taken up on a flaming chariot, which is the word flaming chariot within Hebrew is called macabre. The word macabre.
So the people that wrote the Bible that King James had hired to write the Bible, they definitely knew the science, didn't they?
There's no doubt about it, brother. No doubt about it. I think Brother Olafale is on the line. Let me go and see if that's
all right,
him.
All right.
Brother Olabala, you on here? Brother Olabala, you on here? Okay, I thought that was Brother Olabala. But that's what's going on, Brother L. You know what I'm saying? So hopefully, you know, people are getting some of this information. You got anything that you want to build on that? Concerning what we've been talking about so far?
Yes, like I said before, the people that King James and Hyde, write those books in the Bible, they knew the science. They were Rosicrucians and Freemasons and other esoteric orders. So, but they wrote it in a way that they knew the masses would never grasp on what they were talking about, dealing with the sun, moon, Mercury, Venus, all the planets, the zodiac, and everything is all filled with. I mean, the Bible is all filled with that. The cosmological filled with it.
Right.
The Passover. They talk about really what Easter actually really means, with both the Easter and the Passover. Really, basically, it's the same thing. In the Hebrew and the Jews, they know it as known as the Passover. and Eastern of the Easter sunrise services, dealing with the sun
right.
passing through the equator when the day
right.
Now the daylight outlasts the darkness of the night. You know, it's really fantastic. Really fantastic when you really the more I get the talking with you, studying with you and everything, reading the First World Order. I keep reading the First World Order. I read it once, I don't know how many times, because there's always something that I missed. What is the speed of sound, the speed of thought? Because I always forget. Then I got to go back into the book and read it all over again to really refresh my
right.
That's a refresher course in my mind. To really get it in my mind, get it really synced into it in my head.
Right. Right.
You know, it's you know. Yeah, it's I read other books. Other books I got, like the part one and part two of the I believe the esoteric, the hidden meaning of the Bible, by Higgins.
Right.
What's his name? Geoffrey Higgins. No, it's
right.
not Geoffrey Higgins. I think it is Geoffrey Higgins. Yeah. And he
mm-hmm.
deals in a lot of cosmology in his books. And
right.
a lot of things you talked about, you touched on tonight, what he talks about.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And what you tell me is a lot helpful, especially the understanding the part one and part two of Madame Blavatsky's The Secret Doctrine.
Right.
Because I had a hard time with that, to really get into it, you know, to really what this woman was talking about.
Right,
and,
exactly.
She had made a statement in her book called the ISIS papers. It's called ISIS. You know the
unveiled.
Book. Yes, ISIS,
mm-hmm.
Unveiled.
ISIS unveiled.
At the end of the part
mm-hmm.
two book, after she ended her book, she said, "You people that call these people niggers, these are the people, are the true scientists." You know, and I'm saying, wow. I said, this woman, this is a 19th century woman, European woman.
Right.
So
right.
she really one of the Europeans that really knew the truth.
Right.
Who the true scientists are.
Right. First of all, on the radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. Right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
You get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this the hottest day of the week.
I've seen the numbers in time order and importance. Some of them are in the hearts of the world. Every day of human consciousness and existence, and it definitely has a tool,
nice. gonna be about philosophy, theory, shit that works. You know, that's where the president is.
That's right, you're with First World Order Radio. That's our new commercial. And no doubt, we're here and we're going to make this impact be felt. We're going to go to the radio lines right now and we're going to bring on 347, area code 347, you're on the line.
How y'all doing?
Oh, fine, boy. Great. How you doing?
Good.
Peace.
Chilling. Brother Eileen, Brother L.
Peace.
Yeah. Let me see. Okay. So my question is, it might be a little bit off topic, but it is it's pertaining to the topic at hand. My question is video games. The first sub question I got for that is, what psychological or physical effects does that have on the human psyche, or whatever you want to call it, at this time? Like, because since this is the age of video games, you know, I wanted to know that.
Right. Well, if you go back and watch the movie Lawnmower Man, the European Albion has, being that he's earthbound, in other words, we're talking about 20 to 40% have cusp by pineal gland. They want to be able to survive, and so they want to place themselves in an artificial world or reality, apparent reality, in which that is called virtual reality. And also they want to do what is called transhumanism or trans, and actually do what is called, there's a soul chip in which that they have out, and which they actually, since the early 2000s, actually we was talking about it. But this soul chip is able to be actually be inserted in your brain and actually is able to download all your memories. And so they're able to take that and place it in a robotic android figure or resemblance or likeness of yourself. And that's what they are trying to do now. And so that is gained. So to them, that would be immortality.
Right.
All right, so this
also,
is what they plan on doing. This is just beginning stages of what we're talking about with this video game shit. This is not just for games. They plan on taking this thing to the hill of what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. And I mean, also, it's a greater form of mind control. I see the people that are like, they're hype or they're anticipated or they have anxiety for these particular things. And I see it,
right.
It's like, it's worse than TV. You see what I'm saying? It's like,
yeah, it is.
When they have a new, because they have the new consoles coming out soon. So they saying now that all of these people went to the store and pre-ordered them already. The PS4 and all of that Gina sold out.
Right.
So I'm like, damn, you know? Yeah. So, you know, it's a greater form of mind control, in my opinion. Also, like the music, especially with fighting games. I know fighting games was the mind control is based upon musical mind control, because if you play a fighting game without the music on, it hurts your head.
Wow.
Yeah. If you turn down the volume all the way down to zero, it looks like just flip is going on the screen. See what I'm saying? Yeah. Yeah, and also too, the zombie apocalyptic game, you know. And I noticed they like to use the name L. They use the name L a lot, because they had this game that came out recently called The Last of Us. I don't know if y'all heard about it. And the first the main character, his name is Joel.
Right.
And the little girl that he's with, her name is Ellie.
That's not coincidental.
And the virus that's in the game is called cordyceps. That's what turned the zombie into zombies.
Good info, Watt. That's good info. Because that all correlates to the fact of them now talking about the zombies you know, and obviously producing some type of mass, I guess you would say mass pandemic, you know what I'm saying? Both the zombies or those who possess zombie-like tendencies, you know what I'm saying? And I know there's a disease out now in which that is called Magellan, or Magella, in which that is basically a flesh-eating disease in which that is allegedly coming from out of the sky, which is coming from the chemtrails,
you know?
Those who don't have a strong immune system, you know, they are having problems, you know, with that.
Yep. There was a white woman on TV with that, too. I think it was on, what was it called? I think it was on Amazing Race. She had the Magellan disease.
Right.
Yeah, eating her skin, yeah. Yep, that's all it right there. Yep. And I noticed in the game, too, they had a lot of black people in the game. Matter of fact, they did a ritual in the game where they killed two of the black people that actually helped the main characters. The big brother, he shot himself in the head, and the little brother turned into a zombie. And they had to kill him.
Right.
Yep. And they had a leader of the clan that's called Fireflies. I'm like, come on, they giving it up. Because the Firefly is basically representing the illumination of pineal gland. Or the illumination, because it holds golden light. So, and they had a black woman was leading the Fireflies. I mean, come on.
Right.
You know? So all the ritual.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
No doubt about it. Because the Disappearing Act, you know, there's a Disappearing Act in which that is taking place. By 2045, the European don't see themselves here. You're talking about specifically those with the concept of pineal glands, because it's going to be too hot, you know, and the upswelling of kundalini energy would cause them to spontaneous combust, you know what I'm saying? And this is the reason why they're trying their best to put all this energy block up, you know what I'm saying, with the chemtrails, with the harp, you know, tapping into the ionosphere, with the genetically modified organisms, you know, in the foods. You know, all these things is ways in order to, is based on survival. We know that by 2045, you know, that is supposed to be the end of the so-called white race. There's an article, matter of fact, from the New York Times. It says in a few years, there were only, matter of fact, there was 4/16/94. So this article came out April 16th, 1994. It says in a few years, there will only be one person of working age in these countries for every two retirees. In 1994, Italy became the first country in the world with more people over the age of 65 than young people under the age of 15. The article goes on to say that the Estet Research Organization said earlier this year that the numbers of Italians, currently 57 million, actually shrunk by 5,265 in 1993, with the average birth rate in statistics 1.21 or 1.21%. Lowest in the world. So in Italy, fertility is much less the requirement for the replacement of the day, said Joseph Greinlatz of the UN Public Population Division. Now, that goes back to what we were just talking about, because like we were talking about the soul catcher. This article, it says, according to Nexus Magazine, October, November 1996, the Daily Telegraph and the Daily Mail, July 18th, 1996, it said British scientists are developing a concept for a computer chip which, when implanted in the skull behind the eye, it will be able to record a person's entire lifetime thoughts and sensations. Dr. Chris Winter, member of the British Telecom Artificial Life Team, predicts that within 30 years it will be possible to relive other people's lives by playing back experiences on a computer or in a robotic android body. This is the end of death. Combining this information with a record of the person's genes, we can recreate a person's physical, emotional, and spiritual, say Dr. Winter. He and his team of scientists at BT's and Marlefam Health Laboratories near Ipswich caused the chip, the soul catcher. Dr. Winter says an implant chip will be like a aircraft black box and will enhance communication beyond current concepts. For example, police will be able to use it to relive an attack, rape, or murder from the victim's viewpoint to help catch the criminal. It says, I can even play back smell the sounds, the sights of my holiday to friends. Other applications include downloading an older person's experiences into a new, check this out now, into a newborn by transplanting the chip. In other words, reincarnation. In other words, this is artificial reincarnation now. For additional information on the microchip, it says, request all eyes on me, the Illuminati microchip implant, and the Mark of the Beast from Frontline Magazine, May, June of 1996 issue. That's my man, Marcus Klein, who I wrote for Frontline Magazine for about 4 years myself. So this is another reason why we know the information that we know, because we've been doing this thing for quite some time. But we appreciate you, brother, for calling in. You had any other comment or any other question that you want to go into?
Oh, yeah. I just wanted to comment on your particular share that you just gave. Yeah. So that too goes into why we have a lot of zombies out here walking around 42nd and all of these places out in the U.S. mainly, because the U.S. got the largest amount of damn zombies out there.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because this is the greatest country for mind control. This is the most developed country in mind control, so to speak.
Right.
So I see that particular share that you just gave, I see that they are making like templates for the way a particular human being or a person is supposed to act, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
And then they trigger it by buzzwords like get your education, go to school, brush your teeth and all of that, go to sleep. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Exactly. Mm-hmm. Programming.
Exactly. Yeah.
Matter of fact, I mean, we can see that with the Washington, D.C. snipers. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
As a matter of fact, what put them to sleep was a trigger word. It was called ducking the noose. You had sheriff up there. And he was doing all this crying, and then all of a sudden he breaks out and says, a duck in the noose. The next thing you know, they are found asleep at a goddamn rest area.
Yeah.
Somehow ditched the white van that they was in all these days, and then all of a sudden in a blue, some type of blue car. But they was found asleep, because that was a trigger word to put them to sleep, was called duck in a noose.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? You know, and I think what was the sheriff name? Sheriff Buller, something like that. But he was on TV crying. Go back and watch, and you can see him say those key words. This is how we know that there are Manchurian candidates or mind control agents out here.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about it, brother. Appreciate you.
Thank
you.
Yeah, man.
Not at all.
I appreciate y'all too. Appreciate y'all too. Keep listening in.
All right, boy. Peace.
Let's go to 404. Area code 404, you're on the line.
Greetings, brother. How you doing?
Peace.
All right. We good. How are you?
I'm good. A question that I have for you, I want to pick up the goddess, too, there until I say hello. But the question that I have, okay. I had a memo sent to me from a friend of mine that he got it off Facebook. Do you know anything about some national holiday in Chicago for Moors?
Yeah, there's some of the proclamations in which that was signed by the mayor of Chicago. Yeah, but that was signed in several cities, many cities throughout the country. In Charlotte, it is we have one there. We had one in Fayetteville until they got wind of some Moors who was there, who was, I guess, making an uproar about it. Then they decided to strip that away. But there's several other cities in which that has the proclamations in place, in which that is basically that week of Prophet Noble Dr. Ali's birthday is a celebration, brother. Yes.
Brother, is that a recognition to the Moors in America being recognized, or, you know, it's a lot of propaganda that goes around?
No, we would say that that is recognition, brother. You
recognition,
know,
yes. It's real.
But they wanted to come to Fayetteville in order to make it real big. So I got on TV and told them what was really going on, you know, because they were trying to tie the proclamation into all different types of, you know, so-called black stuff. And, you know, and they love doing that. So we just had to get on the news, you know, and set the record straight as best we could. You know, I have the video up. Actually, if you go to YouTube or either to my page, More Heritage, or either to www.dralinelbay.com, that's DRALINELBY, dralinelbay.com, you can go there and actually see the video in which I did with the proclamations, concerning the proclamations, and we was on TV talking about it.
Thank you, brother.
All right, appreciate you, brother. Thank you.
All right, appreciate you more.
I look forward to seeing y'all.
Look forward to seeing you too, God.
We got area code 818. Area code 818, you're on the line.
Good evening, brother.
Good evening. Good evening, God.
Greetings to you both. I'm just calling in because I just wanted you to know, I don't think you're bugging. In fact, a lot of the information that you're – I don't think you're bugging. I heard you say earlier that people think you're bugging. I don't think you're bugging.
At least one person isn't.
Okay. In fact, a lot of the information that you give is making a lot of things clear to me.
Right.
For example, earlier you were talking about how do I put this? Well, you were talking about reincarnation.
Right.
And you were, I don't know, I'm sorry, you had to bear with me on this one.
It's all right. We got 10 minutes.
Okay. Well, let me put it like this. I have visions. I've been having them since I was little.
Right.
I daydream
a
lot.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Okay. Okay. So when you were saying the part about, I know we are our ancestors, right?
Right.
But I was wondering about a particular vision I had, like, many years ago. And I, when the brother was talking about his grandmother or great-grandmother, it kind of brought some things to mind. And it was this one particular vision where I was seeing, I think it was a past, something happened in the past, but it wasn't me.
Right.
It was like a tribal setting. But the thing I don't understand, maybe you can clear up for me, is that I appeared to be little. I couldn't see myself, but I was seeing an event through my eyes. You understand what I'm saying? Something was happening.
Yeah, I got you.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So I'm just wondering, was that me in a past life, or was that my great ancestors?
Right.
It was a big commotion. It was a big commotion going on. It was like a tribal event. I don't know whether it was a bad event or a good event. But there's a lot of movement around.
Okay, let me explain it this way also. You are a concentration of seven generations on your mother's side and seven generations on your father's side. So you have 14 generations concentrated as you, in you, as your genealogy, as your DNA. All right, we're talking about, of course, you have it further back than that, but these are the seven major ones in which that affects your life the most this time around and in this incarnation. And based on that, sometimes vectors or portals are open through via your DNA, because the word intelligence means intel-igent or intel-igenes. In other words, inside your genes, there's someone in which that is speaking or talking from inside your genes, in which that give you what we call intelligence, because it's coming from inside of you, and then it says intel. So there's something in which that is being told to you. You know that light which is DNA, is malleable in that it is based on words and frequencies on which that DNA can be changed. But DNA can also be awakened by words and frequencies, which means the telling factor, the voice from within. So this means that when you tap into your inner self, you're actually tapping into memories of not just your former incarnations, but also of your ancestral incarnations. Okay? Now, if you want your own incarnation, you have to think about where this is occurring at. Is this occurring at the front of the brain, or is this occurring at the back of the brain? If it's at the back of the brain, then that is your own personal Akashic records, known as your own personal library. All right? So that is, yes, that is where your Akashic records, your past lives, your photographic memory takes place at. Now, if you are feeling the pressure from the frontal lobes, then that is your ancestors in which that is embedded inside of you, in which that is speaking through you and to you as forms of symbolism, esoteric communication, in which that you need to pick up in order to know what to do next in a particular event, or they are may showing you a past event in which that can help you in this present, or either showing you a present or a future event in which that they're trying to communicate to you. And I'll give you a good example. My uncle passed away 3 years ago. Last year, he came to me, and he was upstairs, all right, in our old house on Harmon Street in New York, in Brooklyn, and he was cooking. And I had to go upstairs in order to go and see him. Now, stairs in your dream means to ascend. That means that you are spiritually ascending. All right? And that means your consciousness is ascending. You're going higher in consciousness. So this would be somebody that I went into heaven to greet and meet him. When I got there, he told me that I need to read Psalms 13 and Psalm 6. As soon as I woke up out that dream, I read Psalms 13 and Psalm 6. Now, if you get the Living Power of Psalms, which is one of the books that I produce, my wife and I, as well as also, there's another book called The Powers of Psalms, I believe. In there, it tells you that Psalms 13 is a prayer in which that you use to prevent an early death. Psalm 6 is a prayer in which that you use in order to prevent negative things from happening. Why did he tell me to do that? Well, guess what? I found out a few hours later, as I was taking some herbs, I got choked on the herbs and could not breathe because the herbs was caught in my air passage. I thought back to what my uncle was telling me, and the solution was me simply opening my mouth. I was able to breathe through my mouth. I didn't need to breathe through my nose. So the thing was is that I needed to read Psalms 13 and Psalm 6 in order to keep me from dying, because he understood that I would know what Psalms 13 and Psalm 6 meant. Hell, I wrote the book. Okay? So this is what I'm telling you, that you have to see what is being conveyed to you, because they don't just come to you. When an ancestor comes to you through the dream, they're trying to convey and tell you a message in which that is taking place.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And see, you have to feel the pressure of where the occurrence is happening at. Like I said, if it's in front of the brain, then that's the ancestors. If it's at the back of the head, then that's your own personal Akashic records. You tapped into your own past lives. That is where your reincarnation is. The memories of your reincarnations are located at, is at the medulla oblongata, which is at the back of the head. And the ancients in Qigong, what the masters in Qigong would do is actually tap at the back of the head, right up under the hollow area at the point on the back of the head. They would tap there 25 times, 3 times a day in order to scar that area. And by scarring it, that would give you access to your past lives. So you would not just get glimpsed. You would be able to put pieces of this puzzle together. Because now you would begin to start having more deja vu experiences in which that you know that things in which that took place, it was reminiscent to what took place prior to. As a matter of fact, the more deja vu experiences you have, more than likely you either travel, you're mentally, your mind traveled into the future, or either you went through past lives in which that was now being reflected in this lifetime because it went through a similar, you know what I'm saying, situation or event.
Well, actually, I do both.
So, well, there you go. Now, you got to think about where that energy was taking place at that particular time. Was it in the front of the head or was it at the back? And you know how you dream, and you know that, and it's just like a headache. You know what I'm saying? You got a headache, you know, well, some people tell you exactly where it is. Oh, man, that's right at my temples, or that's right at the forehead, or that's right at the back of the head, or that's right. You see what I'm saying? So
this well, what area was the future? Is that thing,
huh?
I don't mean to cut you off. What is a vision where I saw myself doing something in the future?
I can't hear you.
What was a vision where I saw myself doing something in the future?
Right. Well, that's what I'm saying. Your mind went into the future. So more than likely, that means that you were using your medulla oblongata, which is at the back of the head. So that means that it's happened to your own personal Akashic records. In this prior incarnation, getting help from your past incarnations and your memories from your past incarnation, in which that was able to project you into the future in order to solve a problem, obviously, in which that possibly could occur. That's what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that when ancestors come to you, they're trying to convey, just like what Brother Elvis talking about, his grandmother, his great grandmother always come to him when he's doing his meditations and things. That's because he's awakening himself to spiritual communication with his great grandmother, and she'll be able to convey messages to him, you know, that way. Now, matter of fact, let me read a portion of my book right quick, Out of the Womb, Into the Mind. There's a section in which that I'll break this down and I go into it. Let me read that right quick and y'all can see what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Let me, if I can get to it. Okay. Let's see. All right. All right. Let me see. All right, here we go. All right. No, that's not the point. Okay. All right, here it is. This is called The Astral Body and Other Astral Phenomena. This is by A.E. Powell. This is what he says. He says, in certain rare cases, a personality or lower man may be so strongly controlled by karma that the lower manas completely enslave and cannot disentangle itself. The link between the lower and the higher mental, the simple thread that binds it to the master, snaps in two. This is spoken of in occultism as the loss of the soul. Now, this is another part that I wanted to talk on too. Come down. Okay. After physical death, such an astral body is an entity of terrible pessity or potentiality, and is unique in this, that under certain rare conditions, it can reincarnate in the world of men without no instincts save those of the animal, driven only by passions, never even by emotions, with a cunning that no brutal can rival, a wickedness that is deliberate. It touches idle vileness, and is the natural foe of all normal human beings. Now, this right here is talking about specifically these individuals with 60 to 80% pineal gland calcification. That's what that is actually talking about. All right. That's the Europeans, that's the 20 to 35% Asians, and that's the 5 to 15% so called blacks. You know what I'm saying? I want to say that before, because that was part of what we wanted to talk about earlier too. And I'm seeing as I'm going down. So let me see here. Okay. Let me see here, because this don't make no sense why I'm not finding it. Let me see. Okay. This is the ancestral communion, is what it says. Is that the evolved ancestors, which is your internal and external DNA, or joint heirs with Christ, in other words, your higher mind, and are the mediators, which is your heart or essence, between man, which is your lower self, and God, which is your higher self. So this symbolizes that the ancestors are your genes, your DNA. Now, it says righteousness. Someone who dies at an old age from natural cause is held in high regard. Or someone that dies apparently in war for a just cause. Someone that is highly respected, that follows or defines a moral code or passes on an ethnic code to their family, elders, and ancestors before them. Someone that had children during their lifetime. An exception is occasionally made for those that are barren in life. This was based on if they did some exceptional for their community or family. Anyone that serves as a link between the living material world and the spiritual worlds, which is priests, occult, mystics, mediums, psychics, musicians, etc. It says, ancestors are known to do the following. Check this out. Act as mediums or mediators between man and God. Give protection. Act on your behalf as fight your enemies. All right. So that you do not have to accept the act. Except in rare cases, because this is the time of war and it's a time for peace. Help determine if the people around you are friends or foe. Provides perfected insights on matters that has confused you. Keep your grounds and connect to family energy. So that is what the ancestors do. So that's what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. So when the ancestors appear, they are there to act as a medium, or they are there mm-hmm. to give protection, or they are there mm-hmm. to help determine if the people around you are friends or foe. Are they there to provide insight on matters that has confused you? All right? For Brother L, his great-grandmother coming to him, that is what she keeps coming to him about in order to provide perfected insight on matters that mm-hmm. has confused him. Because he told me he had questions concerning her. Mm-hmm. He has questions concerning her. So here she is. All right, well, here I am questioning me.
Mm-hmm. All right, wow.
Right, and also she's there to keep grounds and connected to the family energies. So that's how you keep the family line going, is by giving respect to the family ancestors. Now, mm-hmm. these are individuals that are not considered ancestors, but dead relatives. These are the so-called unrighteous types. All right, now, don't get upset at me, but this is basically what Africans say. People who commit suicide. Criminals, thieves, murderers, liars, etc. General non-repentive, sociopaths, psychopathic, poor characters, promiscuous, cowardly, deceitful, etc. Young people that die unexpectedly or in tragedy. People that die without children, except there's rare exceptions. And people that do not display wisdom or spiritual understanding, overstand their understanding of life. So these are individuals in which that would be considered pushed back or the unworthy. You know what I'm saying? In other words, you won't want them on your altar because you want, just like, for example, you won't want a pedophile or child molester or, you know, someone who committed, you know what I'm saying, know what I'm saying, suicide, you know what I'm saying, things like that, on your altar, you won't want to put them on your altar unless you was praying for them to ascend to the next level. Now, that's possible, too. I give a good example. My cousin, Tim, all right, my mom told me that he got killed during a robbery. You know what I'm saying? You be talking about Brooklyn Hood cats, right? That's where I'm from. So here he is, you know what I'm saying? He robbing a cat, cat shoot him, kills him dead, right? I put Tim's picture on my altar because I'm like, yo, this is my cousin. This is my first cousin. You know what I'm saying? You know, we grew up together. You know, so I start praying for him, right?
Right.
And an ancestor comes and snatched me out my body and takes me to go and see his graduation from becoming a dead relative to being a living ancestor. And he's coming down the aisle. It's like a soul train online, okay, with ancestors on both sides. They clapping and cheering for him, you know, and they wearing African garb, and they've got on all these beautiful garments and things. And he's coming down the aisle like he got on the damn prison uniform on with stripes and shit, you know. But he has a handful of African, but he has a handful of African garbs in his arms, and he's walking down, and he's walking down the aisle, and they're just clapping. But he's looking around, looking bewildered, and I'm standing, and being in my body. Ancestor who pulled me out told me that he can't hear you, because I'm talking, because I'm like, oh, shit, you know, I'm like, oh, snap, you know what I'm saying? You know, damn, yo, you know, he could not hear me, you know what I'm saying? Because I was only given permission to see, because I'm the one in which that helped him get to that level, you know what I'm saying? Through my, you know, through my prayers and through me acknowledging him, transforming him from a dead relative to a living ancestor, you know what I'm saying? So the ancestor was happy that he made it into the ancestral bone of the living ancestors. So they clapping and cheering and everything. He come down the line. I'm like, nigga, break dance. You know, I'm thinking he should be break dancing or something. But he looking all bewildered. You know what I'm saying? Like, what happened? What is going on? I don't know what's happening. You know, and I was trying to, you know, yell to him what was going on and what was happening, but he couldn't hear me. So there's things like that in which I'm talking about. It always happens, you know what I'm saying? So that's the whole thing. Dead relatives of those that are in the afterworld or on the astral plane, possibly the lower astral plane, but receive no honors, like praise, poems, or sacrifices, etc. They are not consulted, nor are they afforded a direct link to the Godhead, so that their living relatives can gain divine insight. In other words, they can't do shit for you when they're in that dead. They just like a zombie. But that's the reason why you can pray for them even after they pass on, to help them graduate to the next level of consciousness. So now, if he has to incarnate again, you know what I'm saying, which more than likely he will be in a much greater, you know what I'm saying, enlightenment stage.
Oh, okay. Well, what about this communication with the what is that? What is that? The idol? Ion sphere? Is that what you said earlier?
What?
The ionosphere. Where all the spirits of the ancestors go. So they can come down. Oh, no, this might sound crazy. They can come down and they can communicate with you too, right?
Right.
With different things. As far as assisting you.
Right.
In different matters and putting pieces together. In the journey.
Well, hold on, let me see, because there's a book called the Unk Book.
Okay.
There's a book called the Unk. It's written by your Unk Amen. Exactly, and I'm glad you reminded me of that. Let me see if I can find the book so I can read that passage right quick, because that is very important of what he says.
Okay. I'm not asking just to be asking when I ask you these things, because I'm experience of certain things, and it's good to have somebody and make it. It's like a confirmation, or it's like explaining it further. Thank you.
I got you.
Okay.
All right. Let me see here. Let me pull it up. Cause I got information here. see if I got it. Okay. In the book by Noor Ankh Ahmed, it's called the Ankh, he states that the ionosphere is the heaven in which Christians, Muslims, and Jews refers to, and that it's in the ionosphere in which that the ancestors go to after leaving their physical body. Now, what that means is this, is that you have a harp system in which that taps directly into and disrupts the communication between us here and the ancestors there. All right? Mm-hmm. And you get this information. You go to Angels Don't Play This Harp. There's a book called Angels Don't Play This Harp. And he speaks mm-hmm. about the fact that this machine purposely disrupts communications in the ionosphere. Hence, that means that it disrupts the communication between us and them. So that means that they are purposely, these beings, these calcified pineal gland beings, all right, mm-hmm. are purposely disrupting the connections between us and our ancestors. So this is the reason why a lot of people are having problems dreaming, lucid dreaming, and so forth and so on. You know what I'm saying? I want to get that information in there too for those that are listening. Okay, mm-hmm. so that is what the book says, the Ankh book talks about, is that the ionosphere is the heaven of the Christians, Muslims, and Jews, basically.
Yes.
All right, so that is where we go to after we leave the physical body. All right,
yes.
Because you have for the electron. Upon death of the physical body or the release of the spirit upon death, not only is the vapor, which is the molecules, the water vapor molecules is released upon the exhalation, but also upon the release is electrons. And these electrons, scientists have looked at under a microscope, and they said that when an electron makes a 360-degree rotation, it disappears from out of sight. But obviously it's making another 360-degree rotation somewhere else, and then it reappears back to make another 360 degrees under the telescope, under the microscope. So that is telling you that it's 720 degrees, as Dr. York always spoke about, and that that's 360 degrees symbolic to a circle, which is spiritual, while the physical is 360 degrees of the square. So a square has 360, a circle mm-hmm. has 360. Two different mm-hmm. shapes, but have the same degrees. The spirit, which is the circle, symbolizes us transforming and leaving the physical body, which is the square. Mm. And we are moving into that. So that's what the ionosphere symbolizes. Matter of fact, the book goes on to say that the ionosphere is a duplicate, is a mirror, and is a duplicate of everything in which that is here on Earth is there in the mirror field. No matter how faint an object is on Earth, it is there. It is impression. It is imposed upon the ionosphere. So that means when you go to sleep at night, you know that when you close your eyes, you go to another world. You go to the dream world or the astral world, which is actually the ionosphere, which has trees. There's cars there. There's people there. There's buildings there. There's grass there. There's whatever else is there. Whatever you see here, it's there. Well, that's the ionosphere. Mm-hmm. That's what he just said in the book, is that it's a mirror of everything on which that is on Earth is there in the ionosphere. So check that out. So when electrons go and leave the physical world, which is the square 360, and goes to the circle 360, it's going to the same, a different world, but with the same impressions and same images. And that's mm-hmm. the first step. That's what the Catholic Church actually would refer to as, remember, they speak about that there's heaven and hell, but there's also purgatory. Well, that would be symbolic mm-hmm. to purgatory.
Yeah.
Okay. And yeah, that's where you would be judged. That would be where you would find out if your heart, which is your spirit or soul, is lighter than a feather, so that you can actually travel on beyond the ionosphere and go to another planet with higher morality, ethnic, righteousness, or et cetera, in order to live, you know, 1,000 years or 10,000 years or 50,000 years or et cetera.
Yeah.
Okay.
The ionosphere. The HARP, they project these microwave energies that they have into the ionosphere to, just like Aline said, to disrupt the communication between our ancestors. I also believe that those that are Christians, Muslims, and Jewish alike, that's their belief that their ancestors is in the, resides in the ionosphere. So therefore, they strongly believe that, and that's why they're so easily, communication is easily disrupted. What do you think about that?
I don't think it's working that good. I think communication is still coming through. So
exactly.
It's not really working.
Like my great grandmother. So I communicated with her.
Communication definitely is coming through, but it still doesn't stop them from having these feeble attempts of being able to do these types of things or want to do these types of things.
Yeah, exactly. What I'm saying, I don't believe my great-grandmother is in the ionosphere. I believe he's at a different plane, but not in the ionosphere like the Christians, Muslims, and the Jewish Hebrews believe. You know,
Well, it's all the same thing, because the ionosphere is not just up, it's around. Remember, you live in the atmospheres. You breathe in the atmospheres.
That's what I'm looking at,
Right. So it's not just up, it's around. It's around you. You know,
right.
So
it's within you.
You know, so that's really what it's talking about.
Mm-hmm, okay.
I want to make that clear. I know it's the way that he explains it, but it's not the way that it is. It's not just up, it's around.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, because your mind will take you up. Okay, I understand what you're saying. Yeah, it's around. Okay. It's in layers, right? You're saying, because I'm not just saying that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. And remember, I said earlier that it's symbolic to the seven states of consciousness. You already have your seven bodies, but you just think that the average person just think that they just one body because it's the physical body.
Yeah,
but yet, if you ask them how many systems is in this physical body, they'll tell you nine. They'll tell you, well, I got my lymphatic system, my circulatory system, so there's nine different systems in this one body, but yet you're not a multidimensional being?
Okay, so we ascend and we did descend throughout the different consciousness levels. Or we get stuck at one and have to elevate to the next. That's what you're saying?
Yep. Exactly. Yeah. In other words, we got to stop getting stuck, and we got to start looking at everything as holistic.
As one. That's
right, as one. As holistic. Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Well, what about this? Okay. As you were talking, an event happened that I was just thinking about when you're talking about the ancestors being. Well, in the transition, when people pass in the transition, is it possible for somebody to have a thought so strong that they want to communicate somebody, and sometimes we are mediators to deliver certain messages to certain people?
Yes, no doubt about it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
No doubt about it.
It was a while back. It was a friend of my son's. And as it was going on, I think they were taking him. We heard that they were taking him to the hospital. And
right.
I know I don't know whether they want to believe me or not, but at that particular time, it seemed like he had a message to give to my son. He just wanted to let him know he loved him and he appreciated him, because I think my son was trying to help him find a place or something. And
that
he wasn't in a lot of pain, and he just wanted him to know. It's like he accepted his death. You know, and
that's called
what?
No, that was First World Order Radio. Go ahead, Goddess.
Oh, okay. Yeah, and it was strange to me, but it's like I could sense certain things. And I thought it was kind of, you know, it ain't something you just say to everybody. But I did mention, right, I did mention to him. But it did go hand in hand with the event that was happening at the time, though.
Right.
And it was like he had a message to give him just before he passed on to this higher spirit or something. So was it possible that this person just had a strong thought at that particular time? He was focusing on him? And probably he couldn't communicate with him, so he put it to somebody else?
Yeah. I mean, we seen that in the movie Ghost. If you go back to see the movie Ghost. The dude, you know, Patrick Swayze couldn't communicate with his girlfriend, so he had to use Whoopi Goldberg in order to do so.
Okay.
Goldberg was a psychic. She was sensitive to spirits. Even though she was using it as a hustle, she actually had a gift.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So, I mean...
What does that mean? What does that mean when it comes to females? So then, if, you know, a lot of discussion is about activating the pineal gland through the kundalini, are females
it's simply to expand. So, all of that is simply to expand. To expand it.
To expand consciousness
and to expand your gifts.
Mm-hmm.
Right? In other words, the more you expand it, the more you're able to control it consciously.
I think I have enough for tonight. It was interesting. Okay. Yeah, cleared up some things and confirmed a lot of things for me, too. I really appreciate the time.
Appreciate you.
Appreciate you. Thank you.
Okay. You both have a good evening.
You too, ma'am.
You too, ma'am.
Peace and love.
Take it easy.
Peace and love.
All right, Brother L, you have any closing remarks before we go here?
Yes. The lecture tonight was splendid. Excellent.
You know what?
Loved it.
Appreciate that.
So we'll do it again. Keep on doing it again. That's all I can say.
First World Order Radio, finally, we are on the air. No doubt. All right.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio.
We get on into some of that order consciousness tonight.
First World Order Radio every Wednesday, 8 p.m.
We got to talk about what is taking place on the planet.
There's always going to be somebody in the building on First World Order Radio. First, we need to let you know we're going to be doing more shows, giving out more information on Wednesdays. Wednesday at 8 o'clock, we are now going to make this is the hottest day of the week.
Preceding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it. Proceeding others in time, order, importance. The most prominent parts, voices, or instruments. Earthly state of human concerns in existence. An indefinite multitude, quantity, or distance. System regulates to bring about specifics in the group based on value and natural characteristics. Current radiates electromagnetistics of sound through the air, same as your thoughts transmits it.
You need to understand how magical this, something like this every Wednesday can become. So you need to start getting your calendar right, get your schedule right. You need to know our intention straight out.
All right, so, I mean, these clues are given throughout the various languages was to piece the puzzle of this ancient mystery school back together again.
And what we plan on doing, both of us, is bringing y'all some surefire dynamite. We're going to take this level up a notch. We're going to have stuff to do here. This is not just going to be about philosophies and theories, shit that works.